Oh, yes, he's in Revelation of the Daleks.
Yes.
Oh, he's brilliant in Revelation of the Daleks. Oh, I might have to watch Revelation of the Daleks later.
He's also in, what was
he's got a brilliant wig in that, like a ginger wig.
He was also in Boone.
Ken Boone.
Britain. An ancient kingdom with legends of violence, cruelty, and torment in its blood. Join your hosts, Ross, John, and James, as they bravely tread where few would dare. Witness their journey into the horrific history of British horror. They are... The General Witchfinders.
So welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, goblins and ghouls, to the 21st episode of the General Witchfinders podcast, our second glorious year. I'm James in Bournemouth in southern England.
I'm John Pountney. I'm in the south of Wales, which is still in the south of Wales.
I'm Ross in Dorchester, which is in the south of England. And in today's episode, we are covering the BBC Ghost Stories for Christmas, in particular, A Warning to the Curious and The Signalman. The Signalman.
And the Signalman.
The Signalman who is a Signalman. Yeah.
Brilliant.
Along the coast of Norfolk, there persists an ancient legend. It is said that in the Dark Ages, when the Vikings were a constant scourge, the three royal crowns of Anglia were hidden in the ground. The crowns, so the legend runs, had a strange power. No foreign army would invade the kingdom of Anglia so long as at least one of them remained undisturbed. Since that time, the site of one crown has been plundered by thieves and its treasure melted down. Another has been covered by the encroaching sea. Only one crown now remains, lying somewhere in its royal burial ground.
A Ghost Story for Christmas is a strand of annual British short television films originally broadcast on BBC One between 1971 and 1978 and revived sporadically by the BBC since 2005. With one exception, the original installments were directed by Lawrence Gordon Clark and, like the first Third Doctor adventure, The Spearhead from Space, the films were all shot on 16mm colour film. The remit behind the series was to provide a television adaptation of a classic ghost story in line with the oral tradition of telling supernatural tales at Christmas. Each installment is a separate adaptation of a short story, ranging between 30 and 50 minutes in duration, and the first five are adaptations of ghost stories by M.R. James. The sixth is based on a short story by Charles Dickens, and the two final installments are original screenplays by Clive Exton and John Bowen, respectively. The stories were titled A Ghost Story for Christmas in listings such as the Radio Times, although this did not appear on screen until The Signalman in 1976. An earlier black and white adaptation of M.R. James' Whistle and I'll Come to You, directed by Jonathan Miller and shown as part of the series Omnibus in 1968, is often cited as an influence upon the production of the films and is sometimes included in as part of the series. For tonight's podcast, we watched A Warning to the Curious, the second of the films broadcast on Christmas Eve in our favourite year of 1972. It featured Peter Vaughan, Clive Swift, Roger Milner.
Not Kevin Roger Frazier. Miller, the Cameroonian footballer.
I was trying to read on this guy. I know I'm going to need glasses soon. I was trying to say, before his breakthrough tour, 1990, Italian 90. And Gilly Frazier, where an amateur archaeologist travels to a remote seaside town in Norfolk to search for the lost crown of Anglia. But after unearthing it, he is haunted by a mysterious figure. And The Signalman from the 22nd of December, 1976, featuring Denholm Elliott, Bernard Lloyd, Reginald Jessop, Karina Wyeth, and in which a railway signalman tells a curious traveller how he's being troubled by a spectre that seems to predict calamity. This, being the sixth of the original run of films, is based on a short story by Dickens, thought to be influenced by Dickens' own involvement with the Staplehurst rail crash in Kent on the 9th of June, 1865. While true passing story. Over a viaduct, the cast iron viaduct fractured, causing most of the carriages to fall into the river below. Dickens was in the first carriage, which derailed sideways, but did not fall completely. It was suspended at a precarious angle, and the coupling of the coach in front, and held up by the remains of the viaduct's masonry. Dickens helped rescue other passengers and was commended for his actions, but the experience subsequently had a profound effect on his life.
Along with witnessing gas ghosts from another planet who tried to take over the bodies of the recently deceased.
He was also travelling on the train with his mistress.
Oh!
And that had big connotations for the rest of his life. Because obviously it wasn't a very Victorian way to be... His mistress and her mother. I watched a programme on it once. You've got orbs in there.
Many orbs. Was Telly Savalas on the train as well?
No.
The zombie Telly Savalas.
No. But it was a horrible true life accident. Lots of people killed. Did we say then how many people were killed?
No, I didn't say. Just said a lot.
It was horrible thing. Mm. Quite a well-known disaster. But do I come clean now to the dear listener that I've made notes for the wrong thing tonight, but I have seen these two things many times.
And recently over Christmas as well.
Yes, I do have thoughts about them quite regularly, so that's fine.
So which one do we start with, Ross?
Let's start with Warning to the Curious.
Great.
So this is... I watched this a couple of days ago and I thought I'd better remind myself what happened in it, as it were. And I thought, well, not much happens in this, but actually I ended up writing quite a few pages of notes on it.
Oh, it's brilliant. It's a masterpiece of colour film television. Strangely, for people of our age, strangely reminiscent of Dad's Army, I find.
Yes.
When Dad's Army went out on location and they shot it on film, that's how this looked, isn't it?
Yes.
Warmington on Sea. I don't know if Warmington on Sea is anywhere near. Do they name the place in this?
I haven't got it in my notes, but
is it Burnstow? Because I think in the story it's Burnstow, or is that I can't remember. Basically, I always mix up in my mind. There's Warning to the Curious and there's Whistle and I'll Come to You. One is based on Felixstowe, which is Burnstow.
Mm.
And the other one is based on, I've gone blank. Carry on anyway.
So where do I know the main protagonist from?
In Porridge.
I was going to say. So is he the one who's like got a budgie and he's like the...
He's in loads of things though. He was in Our Friends in the North. He was in loads of stuff.
I knew it was something to do with prison.
Yeah. He's a brilliant actor.
That's where you'll know him from.
Has he only Fools and Horses as well?
Probably.
Yeah.
At some point.
Why not?
So yes, it starts off with this fantastic kind of narration, doesn't it? So straight away, I was like, this is good. I'm on board with this because, you know, I like a bit of folk horror. And it starts off with this whole kind of the narration, which, John, I'm assuming is just taken straight from the short story.
I don't think it is at all.
I'll go get this on the shelf.
It's substantially changed from the short story. Okay. So the short story is rumoured to be set in 1917 during the First World War.
It's World War, yeah.
Whereas this is changed to like the Great Depression, isn't it? Mm. But it's set in Sebra, which is a pen name for Aldborough in Suffolk,
which
is where Benjamin Britten resided, famously.
Interesting.
This version is substantially different.
Okay.
But thematically very similar to the short story.
Okay.
Whereas the short story is written from the point of view of, there's two characters and Clive Swift replaces those two characters.
Okay. Yeah.
In only the way that Clive Swift can do. I've got to be honest, probably Clive Swift is probably our most reviewed actor in this podcast.
But he pops up and thought, oh, Christ, there he is again. Him and Christopher Lee.
Yeah. So he's in this.
Christopher Lee, Peter Cushing, and Peter Cushing's wife are the main mentioned people.
Clive Swift. So he was in Deathline. He's in this. He's in Frenzy. Mm-hmm. What else is he in?
Whoa. Keeping up appearances.
Boys of the Dam.
Our lost episodes.
TV's keeping up appearances. I wonder, it would be good if they'd done, imagine if they'd done a horror crossover of Keeping Up Appearances. Wow.
I always found it horrific. It was horrible.
Hyacinth and Richard go and stay in a haunted mansion. That would have been absolutely It would have been brilliant. Great.
Halloween special.
I'd love to watch that now with Onslow in the falling into the
Onslow and Daisy in like a four poster.
Yeah, yeah. Nice. I can see it now.
I reread after seeing him again, and as John Gapsit correctly says, making me go, oh Christ, Clive Swift again. I thought, I'm going to reread that interview with Doctor Who magazine.
Yes.
Because I said, I should say, I'm not the Whovian out of us three. But even I was aware of this absolute car crash interview that he gave to Doctor Who magazine, which is like one of the rudest interviews ever. It's amazing.
And who is he talking to, James?
Benjamin.
That's
I don't know if I know the writer. No, that's a shame. If it was Tom Spilsbury, I know Tom Spilsbury, a very nice man. He was the editor. He was he still is a very nice man. He's not dead.
Well, your friend Gary Ross would have known him because he was in two episodes of The Famous Five.
Clive Swift was.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to ask Gary what he thinks about him. That's interesting. I didn't.
Yes, because as I was reading about it today, it said that apparently, like, the reason that Russell C. Davis allowed that interview to go out, and it's, you know, was because he'd been such a dick on set. And there was some sort of payback, as if to say,
yes,
you know. So I've just found it here. Who on earth is Clive Swift?
Amazing.
And the end, it is the interviewer speaks to him and asks him about saying, you know, have you always wanted to act?
Yeah.
But then he kind of goes into like this long ramble, and then he says, I'm happy talking as myself. I've got my own little cabaret show. Well, I say little, but I can do a whole evening. I do it with a young girl. Tell stories about my career. Then it just says chats in length about his show in brackets. I call it Richard Bucket Overflows because I'm rather fed up with people just thinking of me as Richard from Keeping Up Appearances, which they often do. The question: do people sometimes shout Richard at you in the street? Sometimes I tell them to fuck off. Right. And then he says, right, one final question. And he says, I think that's more than enough, isn't it? How many pages are you going to have on Mr. Copper? Well, I was just going to ask, there's no reason why I should talk to you at all. So you shouldn't push it. I'm sure you'll write something very nice. Stony silence.
Amazing.
I know that you think this is all a very big world, this Who business, but it isn't. There are much bigger things in life than this. Well, maybe, but it means a lot to a great deal to many of us. Yeah. Goodbye.
Amazing. Whenever I hear interviews like that, I think that's how I'd behave if I had to do interviews. Because the obsequious, snivelling little journalist talking shit about, you know, one role that you've done in life. Clive Swift was in Frenzy. Clive Swift was in A Warning to Christmas or whatever it's called.
An Excalibur.
Clive Swift was in Excalibur.
Yeah. He was in, he was also in Tales of the Unexpected.
Right. He was in a thing we have watched, which I can't remember the name of, which is called Dead of Night, but it's not the Dead of Night.
No, the CBC series,
A BBC anthology series, which they've recently dug up somewhere. He was in a very good episode of that where four people are in a house party, and I think the ending is that they all realize that they're dead and they're ghosts.
Oh. Mm.
And that's really good. We should review that.
Well, not now. No, you spoil it.
Right, so anyway, let's start with
this. There's also an episode reminder called An Officer and a Car Salesman.
Let's face it, it's a heavyweight CV.
Yeah. There are bigger things than Doctor Who. And I agree with them.
Yeah, he was in Wolf from 1994.
Just kept.
Was that in 1984?
Yeah.
Nice. Wolf.
Yeah. Wolf.
I thought it was later than that. It was ITV Wolf, wasn't it? I didn't watch it.
No. No,
don't like watch adverts. Commercial television.
No.
Right. So,
okay, yeah, so the idea was that we rush through these really quick because there's two of them. Yeah. We've now done 20 minutes and we haven't got to the beginning of it yet.
Yes. Right.
Okay. Well,
so what do we see at the beginning?
We see that another man digging on the hill.
Yeah. Now, before that, we get this that fantastic voiceover narration. Yes. Kind of explaining this whole kind of folk horror thing that in Anglia there were once
the crown.
three kings of Anglia.
Yeah.
And legend has it that if the three crowns, as long as the three crowns remained in Anglia, it would never be invaded.
And is that what the Anglia television little man on the horse was one of the...
No.
But then we're told that, you know, that all came about from around about the time of the Viking invasion, and the Vikings never invaded there. And they said that during time of war, we learn that during time of war, that, you know, that it will stop Britain from being invaded in some way, shape or form. And then we cut to the first guy kind of digging, although he's not digging down very deeply. I did think in terms of an excavation, it's narrow.
Yes.
And then a strange figure who, and I know if the tables were turned, he'd do exactly the same thing. I've got to say, the guy, he had a big kind of a sense of Ross about him.
Which guy? Which what? One?
No digging here. Yeah.
He's Ross-esque.
He does look like the lost cleaver.
Well, I think he used the cleaver to kill someone, didn't he?
He did. Which is strange. And so, yeah, he gets into a row. This kind of tall, kind of dark, but quite sort of emaciated figure arrives.
Swarthy.
Thank you. Yeah, keep going.
Yeah, declares, no digging here. No digging. And the man in very kind of, you know, Britain class warfare, you simple-minded fool, I have permission from the land's owner.
Yeah, it's brilliant,
and then kind of
isn't it?
Throws him to the floor. And then at which point, fortuitously enough, it just happens to be like an axe there, which he then looks at, looks back over at our kind of upper-class archaeologist.
Is it a billhook?
Perhaps, I don't know.
It might be a billhook.
He attacks him and kills him.
Yes,
and then
he does.
And then that's it. Kind of it begins, and we sort of flash forward however many years later, and our protagonist arrives.
From the train?
I would say that it's a billhook, not an axe, James.
Okay, cool.
In case we get any letters.
Yeah. But I thought the thing that it really reminded, you know, and kind of put me in mind of was it's the like Finding of the Sutton Hoo Horde, isn't it?
Definitely
from that part of the world. And again, you know, my favorite woman in the universe, Dr. Nina Ramirez, did a really it's true
after you, Kirsty.
Yeah, of course. Right, did an amazing documentary about the Finding of the Sutton Hoo Horde. And there's it was so similar to this whole thing that out in East Anglia there are kind of remnants of the old kings of Britain and burial grounds of the old kings of Britain and sort of Viking leaders and things such as that. And out there in the fens, the Ministry of Defence were due to start sort of doing tank exercises and training.
Were they really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't realise that.
The archaeologist said, for God's sake, you know, World War II was starting. And he said, look, for God's sakes, you've got to, I think there's a huge burial site here. You've got to let me excavate this before you turn it over to the army. So it's like a race against time. And then, of course, it turns out to be one of the greatest archaeological finds in this country. You can go and see it in the British Museum. It's amazing.
One of the things that made me realise I wanted to be friends with you, John, is when you described my... you said I looked
face.
Like...
the visage.
Yeah. What, you said my face looked like the Sutton Hoo helmet.
Did I?
Yeah.
Accurate.
I don't remember any of this, sorry.
I can confirm.
When was that?
Remember, back in the Cardiff days.
Yeah.
At the beginning of our
the three crown idea, I think, is a brilliant. There's no basis in fact of it at all. It is all totally made up by M.R. James, but I think it is a brilliant. It's almost better than the story in some ways. That the what would you call it? The mystical story feels so realistic that it actually, you know, is better. Thank you. Than the waved at you, good. It's almost better than the story itself because it feels so real, doesn't it? Mm. In this and within the source material that we're discussing.
So we have the chat from Porridge coming to the town, and he's kind of looking a bit down a hill. It's looking like this is kind of,
yeah. His shoes are falling apart.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. He doesn't look like your academic sort of archaeologist, but this is someone who is a more of a treasure hunter, I would say, than an archaeologist. Mm. And he checks himself into a pub. Is that a pub or an inn or someone like that?
It's an inn, yeah, isn't it? It's a I've got to say that all of this film looks beautiful. It looks like where I want to live, basically.
Very atmospheric.
It's really atmospheric. All the waterways and the kind of landscape and the trees, the fens, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Look really lovely in it. And the I don't know how they did the interiors of the pub, but they look absolutely bang on. There is nothing about this that makes you think it was filmed in 1972. It looks like time travel. It looks like the late 20s or early 30s.
Yeah, but I feel like a lot of places from our childhood still looked like that, you know?
Yeah, they did.
You know, and when you watch, like, Most Haunted, you know, if they just got all the crap out of those buildings, they would just look like they did, like, 100 years ago. There's you know, not much has changed in this country, really, apart from, you know, when they turn a lovely cinema into a Wetherspoons, you know. A lot of the pubs still look the same. But I think the guy who is running the inn sort of gets the number of our protagonist.
But he's not running it, Cleves. He's the boots.
Oh, the boots man, yes. But he gets the idea.
He's just the boots. He's just like the waiter or the equivalent.
Right. But he gets the idea that this person's not, hasn't got much money.
Yes.
Hard times.
He gives him his shoes to polish, and then he sees the underneath of his shoes, and they're very worn, aren't they?
Yeah.
So the implication is that he can't afford to. He would have had his shoes rehealed at that point.
Yes. My reading of it was that the original murder was taking place during World War One, and that this is now the interwar years and the Great Depression.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Interesting.
Because on the newspaper, we see on the one newspaper headline, it says 2 million now unemployed.
Yes.
Yes. There's a definite passage of time between the first murder, because the implication is that the guy has been dead for some time. When I say the guy... William Ager, no digging here.
Yeah, but it gives the impression, and I think, which is in both stories, and it's something I get a lot from M.R. James sort of stories, is like a man, normally an older guy, who hasn't got anything. He hasn't got a family. He's someone who's totally alone. Mm. And then both these stories and a lot of these the stories of this ilk have that kind of feeling of, for me, intense loneliness and people who are trying to fill their life with something just because to give them something to do. And something I said to Beck when we was watching these, I said, you know, before you had television and radio and all that kind of stuff, when it got dark, if you didn't have a family, what would you do? They would read, but you know,
a lot of quiet
time. Yeah, a lot of quiet time, and there's a lot of quietness in all of these things.
That's what I bizarrely, because I was doing notes for Whistle and I'll Come to You Tonight, and that's Michael Horden, and at one point I've written that tremendous weight and loneliness. He walks into a room at one point and just the weight of like and the loneliness, and then he remembers he's got the flute and he's like, oh, I've got something to do tonight because he's staying on his own in the hotel. And yeah, M.R. James's protagonists are literally always, I think there's one story where the main character is a lady who is reciting the story to her grandchildren. But I would say that the main protagonists of all M.R. James stories are single men, bachelors, as they were called, then in inverted commas, who are just... lonely, and they go and stay in places, and they kind of just
sit there in the silence.
you just do nothing. Yeah.
Awesome.
It's a strange thing because, in terms of modernity, now you think, God, actually, that would be quite pleasant to not have phones, television, radio, the constant kind of stimulus of you know, if someone wanted to get a hold of you, they've either got a telegram, send you a telegram, or like write you a letter.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, in some of M.R. James's stories, it's mentioned that, you know, there's like three posts in one day.
Mm.
You know, you could write a letter and, you know, the Victorian system worked damn sight better than ours.
I read a great one the other night. I think I read it on Christmas Eve, actually. The Treasure of Abbot Thomas.
Mm. Yes.
And there's a part, if I'm thinking of the right one, it's the one that's down the whale.
Yes. Yeah. Well, that's another BBC adaptation.
Oh, I haven't read that one. I haven't seen that one yet.
Yeah, it's good. It's our mate from, the Stone Tape.
Oh, is it?
You know what a rat sounds like, country boy.
Fantastic. Oh, I need to watch it now then.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, something happens to him, but then he has to send a letter off to someone to come and help him. You know, days for that person to get the letter. Then that person, I think they have to travel. Do they have to travel to another country? You know,
yes. They're in Germany or Belgium or somewhere. Yeah.
How slow things happen.
So it is it's a totally different, but it's a bit like, it's almost, that one is a bit like a Sherlock Holmes kind of feel to it because it's a bit of a mystery, isn't it?
Yeah. Anyway, so he borrows a bike from the boots guy.
The boots.
Yeah. And he swiftly goes for a ride and then just leaves that bike on the side of the road where it could easily get stolen. So it doesn't really look after it very well. But then he goes and visits the exposition vicar who gives him a lot of.
First of all, we get this wonderful sort of shot once again, very moody.
Those folk horror scenes I love.
This kind of Saxon church, middle of nowhere. Awesome, and looks creepy straight away.
Again, it just looks beautiful,
really good atmosphere.
It?
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
so far from Wales. I've never been. I would give it's the North Norfolk coast. Mm. So really, you can't get much further.
North Norfolk digital.
Digital.
You know, across Britain, you can't really get much further away from Wales. I would love to visit the location of that church because it just looks amazing. But the vicar does do a sterling job of kind of explaining what's happening, doesn't he?
Yes. Yeah.
Which is slightly different from the story, but is to all intents and purposes the same thing happens where the kind of carrot is dangled in front of Peter Vaughan's kind of. I think version implies is that it's slightly to do with greed and making money rather than just curiosity.
It feels to me like this person's lost everything and this is his last chance. So it's a mixture of greed but also necessity, I think.
And something to do, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
And yes, we learn, he says that the burial location of the final crown is kind of defended by the people of the area. And doesn't he say, like, the eldest son of each family has to
Of a particular family. The Ager family. But then they realise that there was one, the last surviving one died recently, didn't they?
Yes.
Was it Thomas Ager?
He's very
William
sickly.
Ager.
So he was very sickly, we were told. Oh, yeah.
Yes, consumption.
Yeah, yes. But I think he was also dying knowing that he was the last in his line and he had that had that weight on his shoulders. Yeah, that responsibility was going. Yeah.
So then does he go to the excellent curiosity shop?
Yes.
He does.
To find where the guy that runs the shop is in it for about 10 seconds and steals the entire show.
Yeah. Wasn't it the guy who was the child antiques specialist? of a Wogan.
Do you mean James, aka Lauren Harris?
Yeah,
no, I think it's a slightly different person.
That's another good friend of yours, isn't it, John?
What? Who I directed a pop video
rock
for?
Video for.
No, it's not her. Yes, another scene which is fantastic. Not in the book at all, and very weird kind of feeling where the guy is talking about his doll called Susan, and then he sees a little body in a case and they talk about how it's in the foundation of bridges or something like
yes.
that?
Yes. Yeah, it's more folk horror. They just yeah. I thought, oh, they're just dishing it out.
So they, yeah, they really elaborate on the folk horror in this part. And yeah, like I say, that's not in the original story at all. So that is a good kind of... I don't know who wrote these. Who wrote these clues? Was it Lawrence Gordon Clark as well? That wrote
yeah,
the
he wrote all of them, didn't he?
Because the screenplay is written by someone who's very literate and knows their subject well enough to kind of augment it in a way which feels totally natural, which often isn't the case with stuff like this. See also the John Hurt version of Whistle and I'll Come to You, which hasn't really got anything to do with the original story. By chance, a book falls, and it turns out that is it a Bible?
It's
which
the family
is owned
Bible,
by,
isn't it? From the Jaeger family.
It's the Jaeger family's Bible. So we see more links to the Jaeger kind of clan. And then we move into the search for the location of the crowns, basically, don't we?
And then he goes off and finds like this this old house where and yes. there's a woman there who's putting out her washing, and then the dog attacks him.
Yes. And the woman has got the best hairstyle I've ever seen. She's got literally the most amazing 70s stroke peasant kind of feather cut that's ever been on television.
Better and it's than just the girl from Deathline. That was our favourite hair.
It's a very similar haircut, actually, yeah. isn't it? Yeah. She looks like she's dipped her head in like the chip bat. She's come out to do this scene.
Was this filmed the same year as Deathline? Was Deathline 1972 as well?
Almost certainly, yes. Yeah. I would have thought so. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was in the fashion.
So Clive Smith would have filmed this the same year.
Wow. Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. And the same year as Frenzy.
Yeah.
So he had a bumper year. he took 1973 off, probably. So, yeah, he goes there. They talk about William Jaeger.
It said that he was always sort of like messing around on this sort of hill behind the yes. house. And she said she still sees a tramp sort of hanging around out there, but he never comes down. There's the first of this sort of the Jaeger figure up on there.
Well, just before that, we see kind of like this mysterious figure just ahead of him. Mm. And he walks around the corner, only to find out he's back, which is quite good and spooky.
Dressed in a kind of Liam Gallagher-esque kind of scooter jacket, poncho thing, yeah. Also reminds me of the outfits that it's worn in Rock and Roll Circus when they do, the song, it's a crap song, like Ballad of the Common People or something.
Well, don't the Beatles have something like that on the Help album cover as well?
They're proper clothes, though. They're actual clothes for like keeping warm and dry. Whereas the Stones and John and Yoko are wearing these stupid like felt hats and these stupid capes in Rock and Roll Circus. And I think that's the reason Rock and Roll Circus wasn't released for 25 years. It's not because The Who outdid the Rolling Stones. It's because they're wearing stupid hats made of felt and Yoko Ono's on it. And Yoko Ono should be banned from everything. If she was in this, I wouldn't even like this.
Ooh.
Wow.
So one thing I've written here is bird song and wind. I think that literally the whole of this episode has got really beautiful sound effects on it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And some good radiophonic workshop era.
Yes.
Like,
yeah. Eerie.
That kind of
thing,
isn't it?
How they effect do that. On that. It's reverse, isn't it?
Oh, it's something reversed, but I don't know what is reversed. Like, is it a triangle?
Your voice from the future. So they took that back in time. Yeah.
The other thing Delia. I noticed, and I thought, oh, how things have changed now as well, is it said this that the lady who he speaks to, whose dog is with the great hair, whose dog attacks him, she says that, oh, you know, you're from London too. Obviously recognises his accent. But what was amazing was when I watched the credits at the end, she's just listed as woman. And I thought, God,
yeah, because there was no other women in it.
Exactly. It was like, can't she even the only, a character name.
She is the only woman in it, actually, isn't she? Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
It's so sparsely populated that it's quite hard to kind of...
At least there was a woman in this one. Oh, no, there was a woman in the other film as well, but she got chucked out of the train.
Those woods That's going to be his digging
location. Okay, this is a bit I didn't understand, and I didn't understand the second time either. Does he pretend to leave in order to...
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's how I read it.
Yeah, so he pretends to leave in order to sort of make the fact he's going to go and dig this a secret. So he takes the train to the next stop and then walks back, it looks like.
Yes, yeah.
And then he all night he's digging.
That happens in the story as well, in the written story.
Okay. And while he's digging, he hears a spectral laugh.
Yeah, okay, so I put, it's a laugh or a cough. I couldn't work out if it was a laugh or a cough.
A little of both. I was... Yes. Yeah, like that. But beautifully done, John. Two for two on the sound effects, mate.
I've great. Also got tuberculosis, actually, which is...
And then he, first of all, he finds the skull.
Mm.
And he realizes, oh, I'm close, and because keep digging. It did look like very loose sand.
Yes,
so it's something that had been, you know.
Looks like he's digging on Browsey Island to me.
He does. Yeah.
In this story, he is digging in next to the sea in sandbanks.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
So
fair
it's very enough. Loose.
That's cool. And then he finds the crown, produces it, and sort of legs it back to the hotel.
Mm.
Yeah, but then when he gets on the train to come back. The guard thinks that someone else is getting on the train as well.
You've missed the part where he's walking back to the station and comes across the guy stood blocking his way.
Yes, he feels he's being followed.
Yes.
Which is nice and creepy.
Yes.
And then all of a sudden it's like, oh, now the guy's in front of me. And you think it's the same
spectral apparition.
It's not. It's
just someone saying
a yokel.
There's plenty of time.
Time? What are you running for?
Yeah,
but as he walks past, the yokel sees a figure
following him. Right.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah. It's beautifully done.
Yeah, and then when he gets on the train, the train guard thinks someone else goes to open the door for someone else, and they say, sorry, I'm mistaken. I thought someone else was getting on the train, which was brilliant. I love that.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, but then he goes back to the hotel, and then he starts hearing like the same coughing laugh in the room, and then all the lights go out.
Oh, and also someone has torn up the family book.
Yes,
yeah.
So he's panning his torch around the room because he knows someone's in the room, and then he sees someone crouched on the floor who turns their head, and then the light goes off.
Yes,
great,
fantastic. You know,
yes.
Hasn't been done better in like a Conjuring or a or anything like
because
that.
Because there's no sound, there's no like
boom
kind of that's sound effect. It's literally silent, and it's just like it's really spooky. I wouldn't say it's a jump scare as such, but it is like intensely creepy.
Yeah.
In the way the story intends.
So the next morning, he comes across Clive Swift, who's painting. down on the on the portrait. We are back, actually.
That's a different I haven't seen that edit of it. Next morning he sees Clive Swift.
Yes.
Painting.
Yes. And Clive Swift, they're talking, he's like, oh look, a figure's just appeared just where I was gonna paint one. That's life imitating art. And it's like again, John Lennon watching him from the distance.
But that I always think watching this that they were so lucky to have the weather they're describing on the day that they're shooting. So I don't know whether they actually like rehearsed that or if that's an ad lib about you can't see where the land ends and the sky begins or something like that. Because it is literally what they're describing. And, you know, British weather is so various that, you know, you could not rely on that from 1 minute to the next.
No,
could you?
No, and they didn't have CGI to change
it. There's no. Are there any effects in this at all? I'm struggling to think that there's any kind of practical effects whatsoever.
No, maybe a bit of white face paint. That's about it.
Yeah, yeah. There's no camera effects, is there?
So basically, he ropes Richard Bouquet to come and help him bury the crown again because.
Yes.
Obviously, he's freaked out by the thing which is in his room, which is scratching at the case, trying to get it back, ripping up the thing.
He's always been there since he dug it up. And the boots is freaked out at one point as well, isn't it? Is there a point where someone goes in a room and the boots says, well, there's no one here, sir. Yeah. It's just you. Yeah. And I've got to say at this point, the boots for me is the highlight of this play. He is the camp icon of 1970s Britain, Like, he's so arch and like Kenneth Williams about all of his, like, kind of like gossipy, saucy, oh, I don't know, sir, I don't know that name, I'm sure, kind of thing, which is, I don't know if that's even a Norfolk accent. I mean, it's just the kind of yokely accent they do, isn't it? It's not specific to a place. But the boots is just, I think it's fantastic. And we were watching something the other day, and there was another boots in that, and Hell was like, is it the same boots? And I was like, no, it's a different actor. But a boots was obviously something that was very popular at the time, with like a waistcoat and a, you know, they had a specific kind of outfit that they wore, presumably. But their job, I presume, was just to polish boots all the time.
Cargo, he was a Canadian actor.
Was he really?
Yes.
And what happened to him, Cleves?
He died eventually in 2006, age 76.
Wow.
Inc. back in Canada.
Oh, bless him.
Yes, so they go and bury the crown, and we think it's all over.
That's
the end of that.
Yeah, but that's a stupid, you know. The wages of sin is death, Cleves, as we all know.
So the next morning, Clive Swift goes to find Chat from Porridge, and the boot said, "Well, he already left with someone, and I'm sure it was you."
Yes.
He realizes, doesn't he? He looks over his shoulder and realizes that he is being pursued.
Yeah.
Yes, again.
But I was when I rewatched this, I watched it at double speed in order to get my. And this is where it turned into.
Oh my God!
Benny Hill. Which I might pop on
Yakety Sacks.
Yeah. So I might pop this on. I might do that on Twitter for this episode. Right. But so it was lots of chasing through the woods. Yeah.
It's very well paced, and it's kind of well put together. Pace, well, it's well edited.
At double speed.
he keeps doing this thing, doesn't he, where he stops and does like a really exaggerated double check and then starts running again.
Keep running, man. And don't stop running.
Poor old Clive Swift does, which all of us would do. Completely out of breath. Can't keep up.
Yeah, he can't keep up.
But he sees on the horizon a figure just with the, what's the hook called, John?
The bill hook.
Bill hook just hacking away at something on the ground.
And he goes, oh no, doesn't he? It's kind of a very weird response.
And that's what I've always thought, James, that his response is very strange and it's very emotive and not very British.
Yeah.
And it's just like he starts, sits down and he starts crying. Which I think actually is quite a realistic, rather than
just overwhelmed by all.
What you'd usually see in a British thing is like someone probably just being like, "Oh dear, poor fellow," and then you know trudging off.
Doing that.
He cries, and it's quite an interesting response. And then, he leaves. He goes to get on the train, there is the kind of impression or kind of implication that Ager is following him onto the train then, isn't it?
Yes, same thing happens with the guard mistakenly thinks there's two people in the carriage.
Him.
Yes.
Very good. Excellent ending.
Tied up.
Yes.
Yeah. And I, if you haven't read the story, both of you, I would suggest the story very heavily, and it's jolly good, and if you think of it as being set in the First World War, I think it does make a lot more sense then in terms of the kind of symbolism that is coming across.
In my mind, I thought we'd take 20 minutes doing that. That was an hour. Okay. So, this one feels, for me, this had a lot fewer notes. So,
yes. This is fairly straightforward, but it's still a very good ghost story.
We are now, like we said, coming up to 1976, a few years
The year off. Of punk. Anarchy in the UK.
I was about to say, the year of the Sex Pistols on Bill Grundy.
Yes!
You filthy rotter.
You dirty filthy fucking bastard. Rotter. Shit. Nothing. A rude word.
Iconic.
History was made because Freddie Mercury was at the dentist.
That's a t-shirt. That's a t-shirt.
That's what I always... Whenever I watch these films, I try and think what else is happening around these films. And I think, you know, that's the interesting part of culture, that you're watching stuff in a continuum rather than a kind of on its own.
Yeah.
And it's mad to think that this was on TV at the same time that, you know, Johnny Rotten was like 18 or something. And now he's like 65 and he's fat and, you know, advertises butter. Yeah. And he's Brexit probably and Trump, isn't he? And this still, because of the magic of film and TV, stands up as a paradigm of taste and good filmmaking, because films don't get old in that way, thankfully. And it's got the fantastic Denham Elliott in it as well.
Yes.
You can't go wrong with Denham Elliott, really, can you?
You cannot.
So
no.
Why do I know Denham Elliott?
He's in Indiana Jones.
Oh, yes, of course. Of course.
So he's in the first one and the third one, is that right? And then he's dead by the 2008 one, isn't he? Yeah. But you see him in a photo, don't you?
And they've built a statue to him.
Have they really?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, they go past the statue.
That's amazing. That's amazing.
Seen that film once.
Oh, it's a... for me, Indiana Jones and the... What is it called? Kingdom of the Crystal Skull?
The Crystal Skull, yeah.
That is a terrible film. And I'll tell you why. Because it mixes supernatural with UFOs. And I think that is the biggest rule breaker. You can have supernatural and the uncanny, but you can't mix it with UFOs. You can have one or the other. Zach Bagans tries it. And he ends up threatening someone with a samurai sword. It's too much. It's too much even for Zach Bagans.
Oh, very quickly, Ross, feel free to cut this out. I listened to it. I'll send you the link if you want. A really amazing podcast just talking about a Skinwalker Ranch.
Yeah.
And the guy who killed all the aliens just saying, and they were trying to figure out, is he just doing it for money or what? And because they were like, obviously none of this shit happened. But they were like, the way that he just kept doubling down, going, no, I've killed them. And he's like, oh, I made one of their heads pop like a zit. And their blood is like acid. But, oh, the moment they died, they faded back to their own dimension and things like this. It's brilliant. If you want to hear it, I'll send you the link. But it was
we have another lonely man.
A single man.
Yeah. There was a single
two
man.
Two single men.
Yeah, two single. Two.
One man is single in it. You don't know if the signalman himself is single or if he does have a wife. But I don't think he mentions a wife, does he?
No. But he did invite a man into his
his booth.
His single and let him sleep by his fire.
Signalman's booth. Yeah. Whenever we watch this, I make Hal watch this quite often. That's basically where I want to live.
It did look very appealing, John.
It just looks so cozy, doesn't
so
it?
Says, doesn't he? He just says, I just sit here and I try and give myself some education.
Yeah.
And I thought, amazing, his job is literally pulling that.
Yeah.
Pulling those levers like twice an hour and then sitting down and reading. I'm like,
reading. No radio. This is the thing that we, I don't think we can get around. I don't think we can get around our heads around is that all of this is like pre-radio, because anywhere like that now you'd have the radio.
Yeah.
It's like, so interesting. You two look at these as if like, oh, I'd love to like an ideal existence where I'm like, this would be, I would kill myself.
Why? A lovely fire, nothing to do.
Just not having to deal with teenage boys all day.
Yeah. A sense of routine. And that's what he takes from it in the story is he's got his sense of routine. He's got a sense of...
For me, I got out of that. It was like a crushing sense of responsibility. And almost he was part of he was a human part of a machine. All he was there, he couldn't stray far enough from that in case he heard the bell. So therefore, he can never switch himself off. And I felt like for me, that's what drove him mad. Like it was almost like the fear that he would miss the signal, he would miss the bell, he would miss like something horrible would happen, and that just drove him insane.
I don't know. I think that he just wants to be there. He wouldn't stray because he's got everything there that he needs, and that's what the other guy says, that you know, I think I've met a contented man because he's got his fire, he's got responsibility, he's got his learning, and that's all he needs. And I think that is a kind of quite a nice idea. Existence, and I know that, yeah. that is the point of the story as well, actually, besides the ghost part. It's to do with a kind of, not a socialist kind of ethic, but something that, you know, Dickens was kind of pointing towards, which was like the emancipation of working people in the Victorian era, where just giving them better rights, paying them better, better standard of housing and stuff. And I think that is, it's quite a tragic story because you feel sorry for the signalman in the end. But
oh, yeah.
He hasn't, I mean, it's a bit like a flash forward, isn't it? But maybe the first time that it's a future ghost rather than a ghost from the past because he's seeing his own ghost, isn't
himself.
He?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, which is quite a terrifying idea, really.
And it's interesting, like, of how Dickens uses the supernatural, because it's this and Christmas Carol, isn't it? And you're quite right that ultimately ghosts represent, for him, that notion of things like regret.
Yes.
In A Christmas Carol, you know, they represent regret of, you know, the life not lived and what he could have done.
And
the decisions he could have made. Whereas in this, as I said, it's, as I think as Ross correctly points out, that fear of responsibility, you know, that feeling of responsibility and what, and with the three cases that, or the two cases that we learn about during the thing of, during the narrative is, what could I have done? And could I have? And I thought that's really interesting how he uses kind of like the supernatural with regret.
But regret again, yeah. Actually, I thought of that in terms of with it. So what are the case? So basically, we've got a guy who is having a wander in the countryside, and you find out in the story, and it's hinted at here that he's just been released from prison.
Oh, and okay.
I think the character in. Because he says something about, like, something like, I've known confinement. And that is, so when, you know, the signalman says, I'm stuck here, I can't leave, blah, blah, blah. This guy says, I've known confinement in my time. But in the actual story, you find, I think it's a recurring character in Dickens' stories. I might be wrong there, but I think it is. And he has been in prison before the story. Because this story wasn't in a book. I think it was in, like, a you know, like a monthly magazine or like a Penny Dreadful kind of thing. So basically, this guy is just having a mooch around the countryside, isn't he? And sees the signalman, starts calling to him. Oh, below there! Hello down there! Goes down, has a chat with him, but it freaks out Denham Elliot because he thinks he's heard that before, and he thinks he's seen the figure before with one arm covering its face and the other arm waving. I mean, the story just unfolds then, really. But again, I will say for Lawrence Gordon Clark, it's beautifully shot. And there's one of the shots where the guy is returning to the hotel that he's staying in. And it's very misty. And you see the sign of the inn. Mm-hmm. It's one of the best shots in, like, the history of film because it just looks amazing. And I love that frame more than anything. It's just fantastic because it's so English.
And when they show him in the room on his own,
yes,
that just made me so happy that I live now. I don't know. And it's just really interesting how different people get different readings from it and what people find, like, horrific. Like, the idea of being on my own and not being and having to be 100% on the whole time. It's just and having that responsibility of. It's good.
Hang on, point out. We've been a bit vague here. The guy who we believe as John says, has been released from prison, starts talking to Denholm Elliot, who is the signalman, and they fall into conversation. And Denholm Elliot says, look, when you came down here the other day and you waved at me, is there a particular reason why you picked those words and you said that? And he's like, well, no, I just saw you down there. And he's like, look, I've seen something and I feel I need to talk to someone about it, but I'm worried that you're going to think I'm mad. And he says, well, don't worry. You know, no chance of that, my friend. You know, I'll come back and we'll talk. And then over the subsequent evenings, Denholm Elliot then reveals to this guy that over the last couple of years, I guess, there have been two instances in which he believes he's seen a specter who's warned him of dangers and two crashes that had happened on the line.
Mm-hmm.
There they are. That's a
one crash. Very good. And the second time was a woman falling from the train.
Falling from the train.
It kind of had a vibe that she was thrown.
Yes.
To me as I was.
Yes. Watching. It is. I don't know if it's just something that's put in for the sake of ambiguity, isn't it, really? It's not addressed at all. But she does look a bit like someone's thrown her from the train.
Some amazing visuals, though. Some great...
The visuals in this one are very striking. After the train crash is brilliant, because you've just got this red light in the tunnel. So it's all suggested, but you don't question for a minute the kind of mise-en-scène, to sound particularly pretentious. Because it just all feels very true. And then you see the lady being thrown from the train is very kind of startling.
Mm-hmm. And her cat being carried away as well. Yes. Another amazing image.
It's really well put together.
And I think the tunnel and the rail tracks just allows for some great composition, the framing, the centralization of the line, and it's just looking into the tunnel, looking out of the tunnel. There's just some amazing,
images.
And the main thing that we keep seeing is this kind of mask-like figure next to the tunnel waving, which is the kind of flash forward that we find out.
And what I loved there's a really good version of it on Daily Motion, really clear. But when you start seeing that spectre, sometimes you can't quite make it out. It's like you're really looking to see, and then when you see it, it's the kind of thing you see in dreams. Amazing. I really like that kind of feel of ghosts.
But again, it's like an economy of because they didn't have elaborate and over the top special effects. They didn't
try to do it.
Yeah. So they didn't do too much.
No.
So you've just got a bit like my reasoning with Terminator 2 and CGI stuff. You watch films now and it's literally like watching someone else play a computer game. I tried watching Ready Player One the other day, and it's all CGI. And I'm just sat there thinking, why am I watching something that's all CGI? I've got no emotional investment in what's happening. Whereas with Terminator 2, they literally did the T-1000 and everything else was real. And it works really well. And you watch it now 30 years later and it still looks really good. This, you watch it now, 30 years later, and it still looks, 45 years later.
5 years, yeah.
It still looks really good because they don't over-egg the effects. And I think that's the key with effects always, is to not to kind of splurge on things that go against the laws of physics. And I think that's so often what happens with special effects now is, oh, we're going to do this shot and you've never seen anything like this before. And it's like, well, I've never seen anything like this before because it's unrealistic. And then I'm kind of divorced from what is happening on the screen. And this is why this works so well, is because all of the effects are, and a bit like Warning to the Curious, there's no effects at all. There's literally not one special effect in it. So it plays totally straight. And I think this is the strength of these films, is that there's no jiggery pokery. Use a very technical phrase.
A cool term. Yeah.
So essentially, the signalman is like, he's trying to tell me something, but I don't know what it is. And what if I could stop whatever disaster is trying to tell me? But I don't know what it is, and it's driving him nuts. And then he ends up like going to the spectre, standing in the middle of the line. Shouting at this thing, tell me what is it? What is going to happen? While he's doing that, our other chap, he's running across the countryside because the train's coming, and he's trying to tell him the train's coming, and essentially he gets mown down by the train.
So at that point, do you think that the other guy is kind of twigged, or kind of the pennies dropped?
Yes.
It's quite hard to work out there, isn't it?
Why he's doing that. Yeah.
What his motivation is, but I think that he suddenly
It sort of comes to him in dreams, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It makes sense to him, which once again ties back to that whole kind of Dickens and dream and ghosts and all the rest of it.
It's very, it's quite a tragic story. It's quite a sad ending because it's like, and it's quite interesting because the guy has done nothing wrong. Mm. And it's not like the baddie has died.
No.
Mm. There's no baddie.
It's not, it's morality. Like, it's not morality.
No.
But,
no, it's just like nice this guy who's actually quite a nice guy. Oh, yeah. And like, you know, you'd go for a pint with him.
Yeah, all he wants to do is stop a tragedy happening. That's it.
Yeah, mm. yeah. And then he gets mown down. And then, you know, really, that's, I mean, that is that the end? Is yeah. it literally just?
Yeah, that's it. Bang. Yeah.
Is it then a shot of them carrying him away and the guy looks sad and that's it? It is, isn't it?
And considering, you know, these both ran with the same length, we did that one in 8 minutes, whereas we took an hour to do the first one. So it's.
The other one has got a lot of plot.
Exactly.
And the other one we were setting up, kind of general, you know, the introduction, talking about Clive Swift and all of that. Yeah, yeah. So.
I think the other one has got a stronger subtext. I think this one is quite hard to know what the subtext is because, like I say, the main guy gets killed and he hasn't really done anything. He's done nothing wrong at all. He's just done his job.
Mm.
And I think that's a bit of a, I don't know if that's like, you know, Dickens saying, you know.
You cannot escape your fate.
We need better rights for work. Yeah, but we need better rights for workers because these people are working. They're having shit lives. They're doing all the work and then they're just dying, you know. So we need to give them a break, basically. They need to form a union and get better rights for themselves. And I don't know, you know, maybe that's reading too much into it, but maybe that could be a subtext.
It was.
So are we marking
them?
Okay,
yeah. So how do you want to mark it? Do you want to mark them independently or as a whole?
I think we should... just before we mark them, we've got to say hello to Claire Roberts because I heard from Helen today that she's listened to every episode while she's working and she's listened up to Ghost Watch.
Oh, fantastic.
Right. Hello, so, Claire, hello Claire.
Hello. Hi, Claire.
And
thank you.
We will get your brother-in-law on soon to talk about that film where the worm is in the bottom of the church and dissolves the film through.
Spoilers.
Wow, that
what's it called,
good.
Cleves? I can't remember.
The Lair of the White Worm.
Borderlands?
Borderlands, yeah. But you've ruined it now.
Yeah.
It's a good film.
Give the ending away.
It's a good film.
Yeah. But our brother-in-law directed it, so we'll have to try and get him on at some point.
Lovely. Okay.
Lovely.
Right. Lovely. Oh, lovely.
Ooh. So Mark's out of five, then.
I was going to give it a 4, now I'm going to give it a 5. You talk again.
Whoa, wow.
You always
5 out of 5.
You always talk me up. Yeah, I loved it.
Wow. Loved which them. One then?
Loved them both. I just love them both.
So 5 out of 5 for both?
Yes.
James?
In the round.
I really, really enjoyed them both. 4 out of 5 for me.
Oh,
both.
That might be the highest score, James, apart from...
Well, maybe. I'm going to say, obviously, because I feel... I was going to say, because I thought we were doing... Whistle and I'll Come to You, that this basically is a film that I would live in. And I do kind of feel the same about these two. So I'm going to say 5 out of 5. Well,
great.
This
has been the one that's had that both of them didn't have much to take the piss out of. Do you remember after like these things where you're like,
no,
come
that's,
on.
Yeah,
press
there's
this.
Nothing look, in it that's really.
As you said.
Yeah.
Atmospheric, both really good, interesting stories, gave me plenty to think about, plenty to mull over, both really good use of the ghost story, both really British, bang, bang, or ticks the boxes.
Yeah. A real sense of that kind of English horror of loneliness, coldness, bad weather. It's a quite a specific... I'm reading a thing at the moment called Sense of Place, which is about sense of place. And it goes from basically Beowulf up to the present day. And that mentions about the kind of British psyche of landscape and where what you can read into it is where horror comes from. And it's a lot about like forests, mountains, swamps. Places like this until like the 18th, 19th century were classed as being places that were ugly and horrific and they were to be avoided. And it was where creatures lived and like these, you know, these kind of realms where magic and supernatural stuff happened. And I think these, both these particularly the first one that we've done tonight, really has a sense of like an ancient horror that's lurking, a bit like Nigel Neal. It's not quite as clever as Nigel Neal, but I think the nugget of the kind of Three Crowns thing is it's a brilliant invention that you think.
That's got legs. That's great.
Oh, I'd love, I'd go and look for those Three Crowns if I had the opportunity. 100%.
Felt real.
Yeah.
It felt real. That's the best thing you can say, James, isn't it, really?
Very similitude. Yes.
Yes.
Very, very good.
Yes. Yes.
Felt hats. Yeah. Yeah, that's our highest scoring thing. We've done.
What? Yes.
The omen was...
We've outdone the rats at last.
We've got one more. So we, because the omen was 4-5-4, and this was 5-5-4. Mm. So there we go.
Yeah. I enjoyed it more than the omen because the omen, even still now, has more kind of laughable period details, like the shitty Allegro that you see, and like some of the effects look ropey, don't they?
Him just being allowed to do whatever the hell he likes. I'm just going.
Yeah, I'm going to get on my ambassadorial plane and fly wherever I want.
What are you doing? I can't tell you.
What's James's highest ever score? I'm interested to know what... was it Never Trust the Rabbit?
I really like Never Trust the Rabbit.
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
But after that, it has only been The Omen and this he's given a 4-2.
Yeah.
Wow. Interesting.
Yeah.
Whereas I've given 5 out of 5 to everything.
Yeah. Unless it's something I've picked, which then he tried to give like negative scores to.
I can't wait for you both to watch The Oblong Box.
Yeah, well, that will be the episode after next.
That's the maddest film. I think that's the maddest film I've ever seen.
Whoa!
It's Vincent Price as a like a romantic lead with a woman who looks like a third of his age. It's just insane. The story just is all over the place.
Well, let's hold that
brilliant.
For
looking forward
next
to
month.
It.
Next
yes.
month.
Yeah. It's very good.
So, has anyone got anything they want to talk about which they've seen, watched, done?
I think this one is a combined one, isn't it? Because I think we all watched. We spoke about it at the end of the last episode. It was great. Mark Gatiss' version of M.R. James's The Mezzotint.
Yes.
Over Christmas, which I really enjoyed.
This is part of the same strand, of course.
Mm.
Yes, it is. So that ties in nicely. I thought it was excellent. I thought it was probably the best one since The Signalman. I thought it was stronger than the other two ones that Mark Gatiss has done. They did Number 13 and View from a Hill about 10, 15 years ago. They weren't great. And then the two 70s ones, the one that isn't Lawrence Gordon Clark, and then the one that is Lawrence Gordon Clark. One is The Ice House, which is demented and best forgotten. The other one is called Stigma, and is quite good. There's a lot of gratuitous 70s nudity in that one.
There is bleeding
to death. Did you watch it, James?
I did, because it recommend after I watched The Signalman, YouTube suggested I watch it next. I was like, oh, what's this?
What did you think, James? It's mad, isn't it?
Mad.
Peter Bowles shouting. Mad. It's very dramatic. Yeah. The story is a stone in someone's garden is lifted up. She starts bleeding. She dies.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of Avery-esque.
It's all in Avebury. And then they move to the countryside, the old curse, the old curse of the witch and all of that sort of stuff. But yeah, John's right. That is the plot.
The story is as thin as a fact page. But the end is like a helicopter shot that flies off as she's dying in the car. It's just bizarre. But so I think the one that Mark did this time is the best in Signalman. No problem. At all, really.
Yeah, it really gave me the creeps when the thing started climbing through the window.
It's brilliant. And a lot of people have said online that he shouldn't have gone for the last shot of the total close-up of the face. But I was like, Yeah. I want to see more of it because it's like, bring it in.
And I thought Rory Kinnear was great. And like, I kept going, is it Rory Kinnear? Is it? It's not him. It is. No, it's not. And he was brilliant. Really good.
I think the whole thing, considering, you know, the problems of COVID, they filmed it in COVID, so reduced cast and crew, having to have social distancing. I don't think you could really tell
that any of that played
a part. One very interesting thing that I should add as an aside, my favourite podcast that I listen to, which is the Emma James podcast of the Curious, in their third episode, they reviewed the original story, the M.R. James story, and one of the guys that does that podcast suggested the twist at the end of this story. Should I give the twist away for those who haven't watched it or
switch
read
off
the
now.
Story?
Yeah, go for it. Yeah. I can't remember.
So we're going to do a spoiler. Basically, in the story of the mezzotint, there is no link between the mezzotint and the guy who receives the mezzotint.
Oh, okay.
In the TV version, the implication is that he's the last in line of the family that the poacher is trying to murder in the mezzotint. And that is an idea that was first flagged up in the podcast.
Oh, yeah, that's cool.
I wonder if he heard it.
Well, yeah. 2011 they did that. So he sat on the idea for 10 years if he did hear it. But as they have said, because they reviewed it quite recently, and I listened to that the other day, it is, if you're gonna adapt that story, it is the kind of it gives more flesh to the bones of this story that the threat is actually directed at him rather than the family of the landowner within the picture, because obviously the reveal is then at the end of this story that he sees the picture and it's gone
his
from,
house. Yeah.
It's now his house, which obviously is squeaky bum time for him, isn't it?
Yes.
And I thought it was really good. The effects at the end were excellent.
Yeah. I'm just waiting for it's Richard Wells, isn't it, who did the illustration on this.
Yeah.
So I'm waiting for that to come on his shop so I can get that to
He'll be flogging those now, won't he?
In the toilet next to our Dracula picture from Dracula ADS, would you?
I was really delighted to see that some guy who himself was a TV director had laid into it going,
James, did you see this guy?
I did. And then I thought, God, what an absolutely shit comment that is. So I was like, wait a minute. Person responding to him underneath, that's John. And John just going, you absolute idiot or something. I was like, yes.
This guy was going through Twitter, and everyone that was saying it was bad, he was agreeing with them and said, yes, it's very lame. Like, I met Mark Gatiss in 1985 in a writer's room. I don't like him. A lot of money went to him. And then you looked at this guy's CV on his Twitter. He directed Bergerac.
Yeah.
And something like Tomorrow's World or something.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I was just like, how sad and annoyed.
Still angry
can you be?
It's almost like, man. You know, it's almost like having an argument with someone about changing rooms and then like holding on to that.
Bigotry. Bigotry. If you're out there, Stephen, is his name Stephen?
Stephen Volk, yes.
Stephen Volk. I turned down a job with Chapter because they wanted me to photograph him recently. And I said, guys, there's no way I can photograph Stephen Volk.
There's
bad blood there.
I think he follows us on Twitter.
I hope he's listening. I'm a fan of TV's Changing Rooms with Lawrence Llewellyn Bowen and Anna Ryder Richardson or whatever. Anna Richardson, whatever she's called. And I think people should be able to watch what they like on TV, not be told by some washed up hack who wrote a few films for Ken Russell in the 1970s. On that bombshell.
Next time, I almost said next time on Creeping on Armstrong. So that was a flat. That was a next time on what is this?
What is next time, please?
Okay, next time.
Yes,
and I've got to remember what the name of this podcast is. Next time on General Witchfinders, after running a poll on Twitter to see what we was going to watch next.
Wow.
We are going to be watching The Legend of Hell House.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
The one that I voted for didn't win. I wanted to vote for the crazy. I wanted to watch the crazy kung fu one.
Yeah.
So, yes.
But we can come
which
back.
Is The Legend of Hell House? Is that black and white Roddy McDowell?
No, it's 1978, I think.
Oh, I don't think I know. Oh, I bet this one is going to be shite.
Well, it looked good to me. So it was
well, okay.
It was between Witchfinder General, the Legend of the Kung Fu Panda.
Yeah, we should have watched the Kung Fu one. We should have rigged the vote, basically.
And we're watching The Legend of Hell House. So, listeners, again, one which I quite like the look of. John will probably not watch. And we...
No.
Okay. And then after that, watching The Oblong Blocks.
It is right. The one with Roddy McDowell, and it's terrible.
It's not black and white. It's not black and white, though.
Oh, no. There we are. On that bombshell, dear listener. Thank you, Claire Roberts.
Yeah.
Thank you. And I hope everyone's 2022 has started off yes. better than their 2021s.
Yes.
And God, thank you for continuing to listen. And until next time, farewell.
Yes.
Happy New Year to you all. Love, light, and peace.
Yeah, happy day. Bye. I don't know what I'm doing with this hand.
You have been listening to The General Witchfinder. Support the show and continue the conversation at patreon.com/generalwitchfinders. Subscribe and spread the word at generalwitchfinders.com. Farewell. And don't have nightmares.
One sec. Here it is. It's a museum of... It is called the Museum of Horrible Things. Mm. It's the Little Dean Jail. Forest of Dean.
That's fucking miles from here.
It's got, look, Crime Through the Time Collection, the Iranian Embassy Siege, the Nazi...
The Iranian Embassy Siege?
Yeah.
What on earth?
The Nazi and SS Holocaust Museum.
The Nazi what?
The SS... Nazi and Holocaust Museum.
Oh, right, okay, yeah.
In Quadrophenia, the Collection.
What? Quadrophenia?
Yeah.
Is this just written by a drunk? This no, yeah.
Well, right, all the things I hate. Quadrophenia, the SS.
Nazis.
The Iranian
Celebrity,
Embassy.
Sleaze and Scandal. Special Operations with WW2...
I don't know if I'll come to this, Cleve.
This just sounds like
Crazed Twins and Mafia Gangsters, James this Bond and Beyond, Freaks of Nature.
James Bond.
Bond.
Blue Close Can, History of the British Police, Fascism in Britain, A Black Shirt and Oswald Mosley, Charles Bronson, Albert Perrenpoint, Hangman and Executioner.
Pierpoint.
Yeah.
Who Killed the Bears? These are all those different sections.
Yeah. This just sounds like Brexit the Museum to me.
Brexit the Museum. Have you seen that Farage has gone over to hang out with Djokovic's family? Like, the last thing they need is that clown turning up.
That's mental. What was the premise of Boone?
I don't know.
I have no idea.
He was like a delivery driver of some, or like a, that's the company that he worked for.
What, he was like doing like Amazon deliveries?
Boone.
Oh, no, but
ex-fireman Ken.
Boone.
Anything legal considered. He takes on a variety of jobs. With help from his ex-colleague Harry, his career of courier, bodyguard and private Korea. Investigator begin. TV's Michael Elphick.
So we had Michael Elphick. America had
Magnum
P.I. Magnum P.I., yeah. Well, imagine if there's a crossover, Boone P., Magnum crossover. Apparently, there was a magnum which happened, which took place in the UK, and had Peter Davison in it.
Really?
Yeah.
Don't remember that. I do it. Why would I listen to myself back again?
Because I put loads of lovely special effects on you.
Do you?
Yeah. When you do a bit singing, a bit of echo.
What shall I do some singing now?
You've already done your special effects.
Woo! So what can I do now that you'll put a good effect on?
I don't know.
Perfect. Yeah. I don't need anything on it.
It's my next ringtone.
Yeah. Delia Derbyshire, that is.
That's R.I.P.
He's possessed.
In your face, Brian Eno. Have some
I'd love to go back. I went to Guernsey. I went to Guernsey in 1999, and it's a very strange place. Mm. You feel like you're in Miss Marple.
Ooh, imagine being in Miss Marple.
Right, cut that out as well. Right. That's not appropriate.